first time I knew about Horace King, the bridge builder, and that he was my great-grandfather, was when I was told of a column in the newspaper, Ripley's Believe It or Not. And at that time, I was young, and I was more impressed with Ripley's Believe It or Not than in my great-grandfather. Then, as I learned more about him and I read other articles about him, I became very interested and wanted to know more and more. People sent us articles. Cousin Theo sent articles. I saw books that were written about him and his work. And I was really fascinated to think that this could go on that many years ago, that a master would educate his slave, and the fact that there was such a close connection between the family and my great-grandfather, that he was given his freedom, he was educated. I just think it's a remarkable story and people should know about it.
When I reflect on Horace King as a young boy, a person who was triracial, white, Native American, Indian, and African American, I think it's quite remarkable that he was able to obtain the knowledge that he did and to move as freely as he must have been able to in order to gain the knowledge and the skills that would lead him to the achievements that he did, given the tenor of the times, given that he was a person of color and those opportunities just were not available to that group of people then, and due to the terrible laws that were ruling the land then. So it says to me that he must have been charismatic even as a child, that there was something about him that was compelling, that had people want to include him in their adventures, whether it be going to build a little bridge or a little road, or even to participate in constructing a building, that Horace had access to working with those people then and learning crafts and learning the skills that he did. It would seem to me that it was a testimonial to who he was as an individual, that somehow he was able to gain that kind of freedom when others were not. And that's the person I wish that I knew. That's the person that I wish I could know now. And as this unfolds for me, as the story unfolds, I become more and more excited and want to share it with more people.
I literally grew up at a time when it was what it meant to be white or not white was changing dramatically. I think that for my parents' generation, it was significantly different than my experience. But I still feel that the story of Horace King, I think, was in part lost, and part lost on me because of the fact that he was someone of color, that story was not, that it was buried. And that part of the excitement for me is uncovering not only just the story of a hero, but just something that's a part of me, and uncovering something that goes beneath the layers of feeling feeling shame or feeling confusion or feeling a lack of pride or lack of identity. Out of all of that comes this incredible story about a very focused person who led an extraordinary life. And that is part of the pleasure of the process for me of just finding out about who this person was.
Horace King was one of the most significant but little-known personalities of the 19th century. He was born in 1807 in the Cheraw district of South Carolina.
I was born in South Carolina, a slave, the property of Edward King. He died and his kin sold me to Jeremiah Dunlop of Cheraw. He sold me to John Godwin. I learned the trade of bridge building. Horace King.
John Godwin was King senior by maybe 9 years, so you can see they were fairly close in age.
He was self-taught engineer and architect. He was raised at the knee of his old Indian mother in South Carolina and showed promise
We know that his mother was a woman named Susan, most often called Lucky, who was, for all of her life after she came to Georgia, was either owned by John Godwin, or after the Civil War, she lived with her daughter Clarissa, who had been owned by John Godwin. We can deal with this woman Lucky. We are told by the oldest record that touches on this, that's Cherry's History of Opelika, we're told that Horace's father was a half-breed Indian named Edmund King. But there is no Edmund King on the scene at any time. He disappears. He's simply a name.
In Chesterfield District, South Carolina in the 1820s, a dwelling like this one would have been typical of those that were used to house slaves or servants. Slaves were more typically referred to as servants, by the way, at that time. And a house like this may have been the type that Horace King lived in when he was in Cheraw. Chesterfield District, South Carolina, was still fairly sparsely populated at the beginning of 1820. At that time, however, Moses Rogers brought the first steamboat to Cheraw. Cheraw, South Carolina, was at the head of navigation for the Great Peavy River, which is one of the largest rivers on the East Coast. And having rapid transportation up and down the river made a great deal of difference to the town of Cheraw. And Cheraw suddenly began growing very rapidly. Also in that decade, the first of two bridges were built. The first bridge was built either in 1822 or 1823. We're not sure. The records, they are not clear. That bridge came down in a flood, and it was rebuilt in 1828. This made an enormous difference to the town because that allowed the people just on the other side of the river to have easy access to the port, which was on the western side. And it also meant that the post road, the great federal road that ran from Washington to Atlanta and points west, could come across at Cheraw, and Cheraw became a real stop-off point for people who were in the great migration going to the cotton lands in the west, and there were two coaching inns here. There probably were about 700 people, maybe 250 houses, 30 stores. There was an academy. There was at least one church building, though there were several other denominations. This wasn't as heavily populated with slaves as a great many areas in South Carolina. And some of the slaves that were here in Cheraw had a great deal of freedom. They were allowed to take, and had been all along, boats down to Georgetown and bring them back, which sometimes meant as they were gone as much as a week without any kind of supervision. So some of the slaves here had a great deal of freedom. Someone like Horace King, who we think helped build the bridges here in Cheraw, probably because he was a skilled artisan, probably had a great deal of freedom. As we said, the records are sketchy, so we don't know exactly who John Godwin, who was his owner, was or where he lived, but he would have perhaps just come here to work on these two bridges.
All we know for sure about the credentials of John Godwin and Horace King is that they were in the construction business, and they did live in Cheraw, South Carolina, at the very same time that the inventor of the town lattice mode, then the most current state-of-the-art motor bridge construction, built his first, or one of his first, major river spans. He built it there, and we have to assume that they were assisting him. There's no record of what capacity.
We have to remember that in the 1800s, one did not go to school to become an architect. One simply studied with someone who was an architect, and after that person had undergone so much training, this is part of an apprentice program, that person became certified to do whatever it was, be it building bridges or building homes or whatever the case may be. And this is what happened.